Sir, I have started the live stream.
Okay, fine.
Can you please check once?
YouTube, na?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's there.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's fine.
You usually mute all the, unmute all the participants, isn't it?
They are already muted.
I see.
So, do you want questions in between or in the end only?
Maybe at the end.
Okay, fine. Sure.
So can we start?
Yeah, I think it's time to start.
Let me start the recording.
So maybe you can start the recording and YouTube one, you can, because echo is coming.
You can see my slide, isn't it?
Yes, yes, very much.
Fine.
Your...
Sir, maybe the YouTube thing is open in your end.
Oh, my end, is it? Okay, I thought it is in your end. Yeah, it's fine. It's okay now.
Yeah, sir, we can start.
Yeah, okay. So, welcome you all to this session of Math Clinic India. Today's session is going to be by Professor Vijay Ambat Kumar, and title you all have already seen. So, let me not repeat that. Let me just welcome Professor Vijay Kumar. He is an old friend, and but a short introduction. He did MSc from Cochin in 1980 and PhD from Cochin University of Science and Technology in 86. He worked for some time in the Regional Engineering College and then Cochin University of Science and Technology till 2018. Then he joined the university as a emeritus fellow, and his area of research is graphs and networks. He is a fellow of the Institute of Combinatorics and its applications, which is based at Canada. Professor Vijay Kumar has been very active in math education and helping students in various forms. So he is the regional coordinator of, Mathematics Olympiad from 1990 to 2017. He also does consultancy for Malayalam translations of Kerala Language Institute, and the book he helped in translating was The Man Who Knew Infinity. He's, as I said, he's actively involved in math popularization, writes both in English as well as Malayalam for various magazines. He is mentor for the Inspire program, Department of Science and Technology. He is also vice president of Ramanujan Mathematical Society. He has the pleasure and honor of meeting our earlier president, Professor Abdul J. Kalam, and had the honor of interviewing him, and he had interactions with him. So with this short introduction, let me welcome Professor Vijay Kumar for the today's talk. Please.
Okay, thank you, Professor Rana and Soumya and my colleagues in the math clinic. I'm going to talk on handshakes to bridges, chessboards, and beyond. I'm from Cochin University of Science and Technology. I'm there in different forms from 1978 onwards. So, and I retired in 2018, and I continue as emeritus professor there. As Professor Rana mentioned, apart from my research interest, I have interest in math education also at all levels. So the presentation that I'm going to make will be a general one, in the sense that I always prefer to serve a buffet lunch, not a fixed lunch. So whatever take-home material that you want, you are free to take it. So I will cut across many disciplines where you find applications of graph theory and or network analysis. So I always start my talk for last couple of years with a tribute to an inspiring teacher, former President of India, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, because I was fortunate enough to meet him several times personally and share our ideas. And in fact, he who asked me to spread the culture of mathematics wherever possible and in whatever way possible. So I thought of reaching out to the math clinic. So don't take rest after your first victory, because if you fail in second, more lips are waiting to say that your first victory was just a luck. So if there are student participants, it's a very inspiring quote. So let me also congratulate Laszlo Lovaas, the 2021 Abel laureate, who shared the Abel Prize for 2021. And Professor Lovaas was kind enough to visit Cochin in 2010 when I organized a satellite conference as a satellite conference of the International Congress of Mathematicians. So thanks and congratulations to him. We'll also play a tribute to the great graph theorist or combinatorialist Paul Erdős. I was fortunate to meet him in 1994 October, and this is the photo which I took personally on 7th October 1994 in his office. So with these photos, we will get into the discussion. We are asking, how old is mathematics? Roughly it says 20,000 years. And the broad classification of mathematics comes as continuous and discrete, though there are several intersection points. It's not necessarily disjoint. So in the continuous, as all of you know, you deal with differential calculus, integral calculus, analysis, mechanics, dynamics, differential equations, and so on. And in the other bag, which is not continuous, we call discrete, graph theory, combinatorics, combinatorial designs, coding theory, cryptography, lattice theory, and so on. So all the both the bags are full now, overfull. So this is what is happening in handshake, and we are not supposed to do this during pandemic. So don't shake hands now. Tell namaste. So this is the basic handshake. There are two people and they shake hands. Now this shaking hands, this is also a shake hands, but all the six people shake hands one by one, and then it forms a cycle structure. So A shake hands with B, and finally this person shake hands with this person. This is also another handshake where from 1 to N people shake hands, but the nth person doesn't shake hand with the first one. So this is slightly different, what we call in graph terminology, it's a path, and this is a cycle. Now, this is also another type of handshake where you express confidence to a single person, maybe CEO appointed. They all say that, okay, we are with you. So all of them shake hands with one of them. So we have a star structure, that is in the language of graph theory. So these are all handshakes, and basically the handshake is from two persons. Okay. So all about a party again, not permissible now. So Anu invites 6 guests to her birthday party. Their names are Inder, Vijay, Leela, Mohan, Soumya, and Shruti. When they arrive, they shake hands with each other following the European custom and not the Indian custom. So Inder asks, how many handshakes does this mean? So Leela says 7 × 6, 42. Mohan feels that this is too much. And Soumya wanted to think about this problem and wanted more time. And Vijay says, I don't know. And finally, Sudhi settles with an answer, 21. So those who have not heard this type of puzzles or problems, you think about it and let us agree to either Leela or Sudhi. Now, till some 20th slide, I will not define formally what is a graph. I will just show and you, I will be happy if you can yourself define what will be that, what is meant by a graph. So I take it to the famous coloring problem. So we have in this here, India map. Where the different states of India are colored with the different colors whenever the states have a common boundary. And you know, from the India map, you take Kerala, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu, they have common boundaries. Therefore, suppose I color Kerala with red, which is the apt coloring, because we have communist government, and then Tamil Nadu with yellow, and Karnataka with green. Because all these three states have a common boundaries between any two, I need at least 3 colors to color them, because otherwise it will not be a distinguishable coloring. It will not be a proper coloring. So the problem was, how many colors are required to color the India map so that the adjacent state do not have the same color? So that has a long story, long history. We started in 1852. By a student, Francis Guthrie, and his brother Frederick Guthrie, who asked this question to his teacher, their teacher, De Morgan. De Morgan was a very good teacher. He didn't know the answer, but he asked his teacher Hamilton, whether do you know the answer of this question? The question precisely I will tell the next slide. So Hamilton also was totally ignorant about the possible answer, and he started spreading this question through conferences in mathematics. So during 1850s, Francis Guthrie formulated the four-color problem. He asked whether it is possible to color any map with 4 or fewer colors so that adjacent regions are colored differently. He attempted to prove that the counties of any map could be colored in this map with 4 colors, but he was not successful. So altogether, he was a little bit scared that his simple-looking puzzle was not answerable to his teachers and their teachers and so on. And history says he was a bit scared. Therefore, he left mathematics and joined botany, where he has 2 species in his name, Guthrie. Fine, that is the story. So the famous books, readable books, is 4 Colors Suffice by my good old friend Robin Wilson. And incidentally, Robin Wilson is son of the British, former British Premier Harold Wilson. He is a good friend of Cochin. He has come to Cochin several times and to India also. And Robin Wilson gave me yesterday one thing which I will tell you after 1 minute. So this is the famous letter of De Morgan to Hamilton, which was written on 23rd October 1852, which could be the birth date of the four-color problem. And whatever I told has been asked in this letter. So this is My Dear Hamilton and so on. It is by De Morgan and so on. It is 23rd October 1852. In fact, Robin Wilson sent me last night the photos of this apple and Hacken. You know what happened after several years, maybe 120 years or so? In 1976, 2 American professors, Kenneth Apple and Wolfgang Hacken. Hacken is still alive at the age of 92, 93. with the help of John Koch, a computer programmer, had solved the four color problem, which required 1,200 hours of computer calculation. And this happened to be the first such in the history of mathematical proofs. The problem that was asked, can we use computers to solve or prove a mathematical theorem? So automated theorem proving, machine proving. And that started controversy also whether it is good to say that it is actually a proof. So we are not going to such details now. But that proof became very famous, and it appeared in the New York Times in 1976. The paper news says, now the four color conjecture has been proved by two University of Illinois mathematicians, Kenneth Apple and Wolfgang Haken. But they had an invaluable tool that earlier mathematicians lacked, that is modern computers. The proof of the four color conjecture is unlikely to be of applied significance. Nevertheless, what has been accomplished is a major intellectual feat. The idea of splitting two-dimensional space to some discrete portions. And in fact, four colors suffice. So this is one of the problems in mathematics, the entire mathematics, where the problem in two dimensions is difficult, whereas problems in n dimension, where n is greater than 4, is solved as early as 1970s. So is the story is four colors sufficient to color any map so that adjacent countries do not have the same color? Okay, so that is one aspect. So there were a lot of people who worked for the proofs and disproofs and so on. So many proofs, false proofs, so many disproofs, so many. So P.J. Heywood, Alfred Kempe, Heywood is attributed with five color theorem. Kempe is also involved in the wrong proof of one of the wrong proof of four color problem. And you see the several such experiences and several such articles in the Mathematics Today, 12 informal essays. And the first day cover was issued in United States to honor the solution of the four color problem. It says four colors suffice. So another puzzle is, can you trace this diagram without lifting your pen or without repeating it? So can you do this or can you do this? Anybody who has studied graph theory need not check it. There is a theorem which will ensure that whether it is possible or not. So till some one point, I will not use the word graph at all. That's my plan. Now, another problem in chessboards is what's called the Queen's domination problem. What the Queen's domination problem asks is, what is the minimum number of queens that can be placed on any n by n chessboard so that each square is occupied or attacked by a queen? Shall repeat. So slowly mathematical intricacies have started coming. We are interested in finding the minimum number of queens that can be placed on an n by n chessboard so that each square is occupied or attacked by a queen. If the chessboard is usual 8x8 chessboard, the answer is 5. I will show you one of the possible solutions of the Queen's domination problem for 8x8 chessboard. And it is surprising that there are 4,860 different possibilities of solving this 8x8 chessboard Queen's problem. There's a very good book which I suggest is Watkins Across the Board, Mathematics of Chessboard Problems. There are plenty of problems in this book, which will fetch at least 3 to 5 PhD thesis. So one of the solutions of these queen's domination is, if you place this queen on this like this, here, like here, here, and here, these 5 queens can dominate the entire chessboard in the sense that either each square is occupied by them or it is attacked by them, and 5 is the minimum. So in the modern language, we say that the queen's domination number for 8x8 chessboard is 5. Again, can you find a root starting from any vertex and visiting all other vertices exactly once and return to starting vertex? So can you do this in this picture, which is a regular dodecahedron? So again, going back to 1856, that's what's called Knight's Tour problem. So the problem was, can a knight visit all the 64 squares of an 8x8 chessboard in such a way that each square is visited exactly once and returned to the starting initial square? Or put it in another way, which n-by-n chessboard admit a knight's tour? We know that there is a solution for 8x8 chessboard, but all we can also find which n-by-n, which n. For all values of n, we can have a solution for the knight's tour problem using simple number theorem. So everywhere you find friendship network, chemical network, rail network, network of Indian Airlines, different types of network, corona network and so on and so on. This is the brain network, this is the electrical switching networks and so on. Now this is a interesting thing when you move to chemistry. This is an object called Buckminster fullerene. You know, there were only two forms of carbon known till the invention of this molecule, your carbon and graphite. Till then, there were only two forms of carbon. But this Bucky ball, named after Buckminster fullerene, Buckminster, which is called a fullerene C60, has a nice structure. It's a truncated icosahedron. And Croteau, Curl, and Smalley, chemists, were awarded the 1996 Nobel Prize for their roles in the discovery of this class of molecules. So it has 60 vertices. Each vertex has three neighbors. So naturally, by a simple rule, which I will tell later, similar to the handshake puzzle, it will have 90 vertices. So each face is either a pentagon or hexagon, so 12 pentagons and 20 hexagons. And this dome-shaped buckyball is there in the Montreal city in Canada. And the architect who designed this, Richard Buckminster Fullerene, is not a scientist, he's a planner, he's an architect. I was fortunate enough to see this buckyball when I went to Quebec long back. So this is the shape, and you may ask, what is all this thing to do with mathematics? So the physical property of superconductivity, etc., of this buckyball, fullerene, Buckminster fullerene, was discussed and found by physicist. And now this buckyball is in the hands of mathematicians, specifically graph theorists. And one lady, Professor Fan Chung, has done a lot of work on the stability of this fullerene, Buckminster fullerene, by analyzing spectral analysis of the network or the Buckminster fullerene, and that is now in the hands of mathematicians. So what I wanted to tell you is that those days where mathematicians sit in his own room and being only mathematics have gone. We have to hear what physics people say, chemistry people say, computer science people say, and even now what epidemiologists and phylogenetic people wanted to say. So this is a problem which started in chemistry, went through physics, now in mathematics, to look at the stability of the Buckminster fullerene, analyze its property mathematically. So in all these puzzles or examples which I mentioned, there is a commonness. I feel that mathematics is seeing sameness in different things and differences in the same thing. Okay, so mathematics is seeing sameness in different things. In all these things, there is basically a relation. Relation gives rise to a graph, and graph gives rise to a matrix. And conversely, given a matrix, I can associate a graph and I can associate a relation. So if you follow the Aristotelian logic of dichotomy, either A is related to B or A is not related to B, or on switch is on or off, every question has answer yes or no, black or white, etc. So these objects are represented by points, and if A is related to B, then connect them by a segment. And if A is related to B, assign the value 0 and 0. If A is not related to B, we get a matrix with the 0, 1 as entries. You can quickly see that because the relation is symmetric, because A or B implies B or A, A is related to B implies B is related to A. We have a graph and a matrix, what's called the adjacency matrix, associated with the graph, and converse is also true. So what I want to conclude is that a graph is nothing but a non-empty set together with a symmetric binary relation defined on it. Equivalently, graph can be seen as a binary matrix with entries 0 and 1, which is symmetric. Several aspects of this matrix representation are done. I'm not going into the details. So for matrices, you know, Arthur Cayley and Sylvester were the people who behind this. And in fact, Sylvester is the person who coined the term graph in his famous article on chemistry and algebra. That happened sometime in 1886 or something. So another puzzle, an odd person wishes to conduct an odd party in which odd number of odd persons participate, and each odd person shake hands with odd number of odd persons. Totally confused, right? So is it possible to conduct such an odd party? The word odd written in, sorry, put it in red, and word odd, you put it in violet, they have different meaning. An odd person means, you know, some off person conducting an odd party, something very rare, in which odd number of odd persons participate. So these violet odd and red odd have different meaning, as you see. So is it possible to conduct such a party in which each odd person shake hands with odd number of odd persons? You will find this answer later. So all this came started with a wonderful work of Leonhard Euler, who is called the analysis incarnate, avatar of analysis. He was a totally blind person for about 16 years. That's the most striking information. Euler lost right eye in 1738 and left eye in 1766. And he passed away only in 1783. So for about 17 years, he was totally blind and he did wonders. Starting from music theory to theory of shift, combinatorics, graph theory, design theory, whatnot. At least 14, 15 areas where he was a master. So all this was settled by Euler by solving the famous Königsberg bridge problem, and that could be treated as the origin of graph theory when he solved a problem relating to the geometry of position. Geometry of positions means geometry situs. Analysis of position is graph topology, and geometry of position is graph theory. And by solving this Königsberg bridge problem, which is quite famous, there are 4 land areas and 7 bridges. You have to start at any land area, walk across each bridge exactly once and get back to the land area. Is it possible? That was the Königsberg bridge problem. And as the yellow slide says, information says, the entire the solution of Königsberg bridge problem changed the entire mathematics, and that gave birth to graph theory. So the handshaking lemma, which I mentioned in the beginning, with all about a party, is what is called the for any finite undirected graph. You know what a graph is, has an even number of vertices with odd degree. So in more colloquial form, an even number of people must have shaken an odd number of other people's hands. So you can try to find the solution of the odd party problem that I discussed in the beginning. So this is a very good site, www.theoremoftheday.org. Every day they have a new theorem and some short write-up about such theorems. So when you have a graph, it is related to groups, vector spaces, matrices, metric spaces, number theory, combinatorics, design theory, algebra, networks, mathematical chemistry, and whatnot. So highly interdisciplinary topic, multidisciplinary topic, and graph theory has entered almost all arenas of mathematics, whether it is group theory or network theory or algebra. So the 1736 journey starts now with an graph theory in the information age. So that's what I'm going to discuss first. So let us look at the SARS-CoV virus, that is a pandemic that has been creating trouble for more than 200 countries with about 40 lakhs people dying. And that has created a lot of pandemic scare as well. So if you look at the press news and press release or TV release channel, you will hear the word contact networks, corona cluster, super spreaders, global community transmission. So what has this to do with networks or graph theory? So even the COVID-19 data is being tried by several people, basically with the SIR model, SIR, susceptible, infectious, and recovered model, which was fitted in as early as 1927 to discuss the spread of malaria by Ronald Rose and his team, which is basically a compartmental model by Ronald Rose and others. So I'll describe briefly what is a mathematical model. It's a description of a system using mathematical concepts and languages. We start with a very famous quote by G.E.P. Box, which says that all models are wrong, but some are useful. So we cannot fit a perfect model. So we are very optimistic and trying to look at the situation and try to model it. It may be okay, otherwise may not be okay. That depends. So we don't expect it to also have a complete solution. But all sort of modeling techniques have been applied, I am aware, even in the case of this COVID-19 pandemic. So there are basically black box model and white box model. Blackboard model, I don't have any a priori information. Some information is available in the white box models and try to interpolate using these models. Basically, classification is static versus dynamic. So we are concentrating on the dynamic modeling, where the system is dynamic, continuously changing. That is what is happening in the coronavirus modeling. We don't have a fixed number of corona patients. It increases by any huge number every day. So what type of modeling can be, what type of technique can be applied is a very serious situation and people are at it. So mathematical modeling of infectious diseases, which is basically a compartmental model, which is a differentiation model, is being improved into the new situation where I have SIR model, susceptible, infectious, or recovered. And we can ask why people use masks is that the close proximity interaction level, which is spread, the rapid pandemic spread are usually transmitted via droplets during close proximity interaction. And when the droplet is, the moment the droplets are out of your face or, out of your mouth or nose, very little is known about the dynamic patterns of the close proximity interaction. Therefore, whenever dynamics is there, it is difficult to analyze that. So there is an epidemiological network theory. There is a two-way interaction. The network that is generated provides insights into the epidemiological dynamics, and epidemiological dynamics give birth to a network as well. So in contact network, the population is represented by dots connected by lines, and each member is represented by a node with the disease-causing interactions between two members of a population represented by edges. So this is a very nice paper which appeared in Journal of Biological Dynamics, the dynamic nature of contact networks in infectious disease epidemiology. So starting from computer science to neurology and from social science to statistical physics, networks rules the world. So this is a very interesting thing. I will come back to this if time permits. So in the network, in the epidemiological networks, there is a concept called super spreaders. Super spreaders is an unusually contagious organism infected with a disease. Such super spreaders are of particular concern in epidemiology, and identifying super spreaders is not going to be easy. In this picture, red colored fonts are found to be the super spreaders. And by definition, super spreaders is an individual which can have at least 8 transmissions. And the super spreaders may or may not show any symptoms of the disease. And the entire epidemiological network theory is being attacked by graph theory people and studied. So the super spreader is alternately called hubs in any network. And hub is a node with a number of links that greatly exceeds the average. So many people are getting attracted to the hub, or so many information go out of the hub, right? And the emergence of hubs is a property of scale-free property of networks. And hubs have a significant impact on the network topology. And all the real-world networks that I may discuss has the property of scale-free property, and therefore all of them have hubs. So another thing is the phylogenetic tree, decision tree, sorting tree. All these things are coming out of a tree notion introduced by Arthur Cayley. And the notion of phylogeny fundamental to phylogeny is that plants or animals of different species descended from common ancestors. And looking at the phylogeny of the network helps us to look at the transmission rate of infectious diseases. Even in the SARS-CoV-2, phylogenetic techniques have been applied to look at the transmission rate and the pattern of transmission. So these are some books which are worth reading. And another notion of mathematical chemistry, where graph theory is applied, that's where Cayley contributed, the problem of counting the number of different isomers of a saturated hydrocarbon is equivalent to the number of rooted trees. And that was a wonderful Cayley tree formula. And that is the relationship between mathematics and chemistry, which is now being discussed in the QSPR modeling and Huckel molecular orbital theory. And this is also a thing which you know, which you have studied in the schools, the molecular representation of hydrocarbons, CN, H2N plus 2, and methane, ethane, etc. And this is how mathematical chemistry comes into picture, that is study of chemical properties of molecules via graph theoretic technique. So some graphs are abstract, static, they don't change. So these are all these graphs that you see in the textbooks. They are all static. And this graph is popularly known as Peterson graph. And this graph is named after Indian mathematician Srikhande. This is what's called Srikhande graph, and so on. But most of the real world network graphs or networks are dynamic in nature. They keep on changing. And therefore, analyzing the properties of these dynamic real world networks is not going to be easy. To start with a real-world network, it is that of a human brain, which has got 80 billion nodes, and they are connected with, neurons are there, and they are connected with synapses. But though it is a very highly complex network, it has got several properties which are good for what is called the small world phenomena, which I'll come about later. Each neuron is getting linked with only average 7,000 other neurons. So though we have billions of neurons, the analysis is more interesting because they all fall under the small world phenomenon. So these are all some examples of real world networks, biological networks, and so on. Citation network, food web, world wide web, and so on. And now come to the well-known network, what's called that of the Facebook. Facebook, what is happening in the Facebook? It has got a basic philosophy is that friend of a friend is a friend. I need not be a friend of X or Y, but he could be a common friend of some other friends. Therefore, friend of a friend of a friend is a friend is the basic philosophy of the Facebook network. So how long can you connect? I will come to some surprising results in what is happening in the Facebook network later. So we have 2.7 billion monthly active users in the Facebook. They keep on sending messages, posting photos, sending audio, video, all these things. And tremendous transactions takes place in the Facebook network. But still, it is analyzable that there are many very nice properties that makes mathematicians happy because we are able to control the study of Facebook transmission, Facebook network. Okay, so otherwise, managing a network with the 2.70 billion vertices, 1 billion is 10 raised to 9, is not going to be an easy task. But some control is there because of the beautiful mathematical phenomena, mathematical properties these type of networks have. In all these type of networks which I mentioned, there is a basic possibility or basic property, what's called community structure. So in all real world networks, community structure is very interesting. Now look at this math clinic activity itself. Only those community of people who are interested in mathematics have joined. Okay, right. So there need not be a people from economics or law coming in this group. So the mathematicians form a community in the field of all sciences. So social networks include community group, common location, interests, and so on. Citation networks may have communities by research topic, but detecting community in any arbitrary network is not a easy task. It's a computationally difficult task, but there are certain algorithms which will take solutions to find the communities, and that is a very, very, very good topic in network science. And in this picture, anybody who even don't know the definition of a community can feel that this forms a community, this forms a community, this forms a community. So what is happening within the community? There are more related people, and people from one group very seldom.
Hello.
So from this to this is only very few connections. So these, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, they are the different communities. So within the community, they are all interlinked. They are all well connected, and outside that, there are only very few connections. That is how you find. Identify the community structure. So there are some books on social networks and analyzing the social web. Okay. Now, mathematics enters the theory of evolution. So natural selection has been a cornerstone of evolutionary theory ever since Charles Darwin. Yet mathematical models of natural selection have often been dogged by an awkward problem that seemed to make evolution harder than what biologists understood it to be. So in one of the recent papers in Communications in Biology, there is a very startling revelation that graph theory explains natural selection. So the mathematician or scientist in charge is Martin Novak, who is the director of the Program for Evolutionary Dynamics of Harvard University, came out with a solution or possible attempt to look at the origin of species of Charles Darwin mathematically. And they used graph theory techniques to find more generalizable strategies. That is a very exciting information for graph theory people. And these are the articles which I write in Malayalam about such thing. This is about viral diseases, mathematical epidemiology, and about the connections between human brain. I'm coming to another thing about the brain. This is a basic question. It seems there is an inner GPS in our brain. So how do we know where we are? How can we find the way from one place to another? And how can we store this information in such a way that we can immediately find the way next time we trace the same path? So this is a very, very interesting situation, where I am able to retrace the path sometime after 2-3 days. So not only that, the information are stored in the brain, it is retrieved after a few days or few months, depending on the information. So three people got Nobel Prize in medicine for their wonderful discovery that the brain create a map of the space surrounding us. And the problem of how we can navigate our way through a complex environment was tackled by these medical doctors and biologists. These two are Edward Moser and that lady is their husband and wife, and they got Nobel Prize in 2014. Okay. Grid cells are used to represent information in the brain. These are all some new information. So this is what is happening. So a new insight into the brain connectivity attracted by network theory people as well as biologists is that to how best to model the mechanisms of diseases in the brain. And there is a recent study by Georgia State University which gives birth to the new approach to brain connectivity in a Science Daily article in 2020. I'll be able to conclude in about 5 to 10 minutes. So the whole idea of the World Wide Web was started something like a science fiction in a popular article by a great popular scientist, Arthur Clarke, who predicted that satellites would someday bring the accumulated knowledge of the world to your fingertips. And that is what is happening now. I'm sitting in Cochin and this being recorded in Bombay, and people from different parts of India is attending to this. And that's what Arthur Clarke predicted as early as 1970. There was no internet during 1970. So using a console, and I'm operating with a mouse, using a console that would combine the functionality of the photocopier, telephone, television, and a small computer, allowing data transfer and video conferencing around the globe. So something like science fiction, Arthur Clarke predicted this, which came in the Popular Science magazine in 1970. And in all the analysis that we look at the World Wide Web, there is a Matthew's effect in science, which is there in the Holy Bible, New Testament. The basic point is rich becomes richer and the poor becomes poorer. So for everyone who has will be given more, and he will have more than enough. But anyone who has not will be deprived even of what he has. So that is basically the property of the World Wide Web and all real world networks. Powerful becomes more powerful. Rich people becomes more rich. So this is what's called the preferential attachment. Economics people also use this terminology. And in the network analysis also, network theory also, this principle of Matthew's effect is very much formed. So the web explodes, but still there is a cohesiveness in the webs. In 2020, we estimated active websites is 200 million. And the mathematics that we have to do is with this number of huge number of websites. And there is a result of 2000 by Indian mathematicians, including a mathematician, is that there is a bow tie structure of the web. There is a locally strongly connected component, which is a central core. And that is where more people are interacting with exchanging information in the websites. Some few million people pages enter and few million pages go. And there are some dendrites and tendrils and tubes and so on, which are very less connected to the strongly connected component. So this basic bow tie structure is famous in the construction of the World Wide Web. This is how basically the World Wide Web is designed. I mean, the shape of this structure of this World Wide Web is something like this. So the network is dynamic, and it was in 2006 that some models of what is the diameter of the World Wide Web was attacked by Barbasi, and in the 1999 paper, and in the 2006 Navalnina Prize winner Kleinberg did what is called the small world phenomena and how best you can navigate in the small world phenomena. So there are some books like this which are useful. And this is Duncan Watts, Newman, and Barbasi. Their H index is as high as 145. So I'll need only 5 minutes more. Hope it's fine. So the real world networks, what are the properties that you can expect of a real world networks is that, as I mentioned, the case of brain network, though there are billions of nodes or neurons, not all neurons are getting connected to all the other neurons. So average degree is only 7,000. Therefore, there are many neurons which are not interacted. There is no synapses connecting them. And therefore, the basic structure is that the adjacency matrix of the network, it is sparse, in the sense that there are more zeros than ones. So the number of edges, when you get one, whenever they are adjacent, when there is an edge, you put an edge, there is one, and if they are not adjacent, you put a zero. So in the sparse city, is the number of edges is within a constant multiple of the number of vertices. So this is what's called the Duncan Watts and Strogatz small world phenomena. It's a beautiful book, Small Worlds. So the basic theory is that any two vertices are connected by a shortest path. Not necessarily any two vertices are adjacent. but I can still connect from one point to another point by a shortest path. So two vertices having a common neighbor are more likely to be neighbors through the common neighbor. So that is the basic philosophy of this epidemiological network. You find a common set of people who are going to be the carriers of the diseases. Okay, and also you are going to find a common friend in a Facebook network or social networks. So most nodes are not neighbors of one another, but most nodes can be reached from every other by a small number of hopes and sets, and that's what's called the small world phenomena. And what Kleinberg's paper and book says is that Facebook is a small world. So it is searchable. There is two persons who are five friends links away could navigate from one person to the other by knowing only the friends at each point, but not knowing any one's friends or friends. That is, friend of a friend of a friend is a friend. That is the basic theory of Facebook. There is a notion of clustering coefficient, which is true for a real world network, which I am not going into details. This is a simple example to look at the hubs. Hubs are bigger than, this is a hub because this is where the average, the degree of that vertex increases is much, much more than the average degree of the network. So average degree is 3.8, whereas, you know, the degree of this vertex is 8. And average shortest path length is 1.803. You can calculate the clustering coefficient. This is one of the invariant of the real world networks. So I will conclude with one observation that all these real world networks satisfy a law. I am not going to the mathematics of it, but I will show you with a curve. And this is what is happening in the case of all real world networks. It is not the Poisson distribution. It is the power law distribution. That is the distribution of the degrees of the vertices follow a power law. So what do you mean by, in a colloquial terms, that very many nodes with only a few links? That's what is happening in the World Wide Web. That's what is happening in the brain network. That's also what is happening in the protein-protein interaction network. So these are all examples of real-world networks or scale-free networks or networks following a power law. So very many nodes with only a few links and a few hubs with large number of links. So there is a tailed distribution is there, and that is the power law distribution. And as I showed in the beginning earlier, that satisfies the y is equal to mx plus c. So this minus beta is the slope of the straight line, and minus beta, the beta is what's called the exponent of the power law, is the hero or villain, and finding beta is a very difficult problem in the real world networks. So protein-protein interaction networks is an example of a biological network, a real network, and Stubbs in a 2002 paper has proved that in the case of a protein-protein interaction network, in the case of yeast, has the power law exponent 1.6. So many examples of small world phenomena are there: neural network, water networks, telephone call graphs, and so on. Scale-free networks is basically the network which follows the power law distribution. So highest degree nodes are often called hubs or super spreaders, and they are found in the real world network. So existence of hubs is a property of the scale-free networks, which you do not find in the case of random graphs. So I will conclude with the 6 degree of separation experiment. The basic theory is that 6 degrees of separation. Okay, everyone is at most 6 steps away from any other person on Earth. That is the famous theory of Duncan Watts, named after six degrees. So we have a small world phenomena. We can handshake, there is a 6 handshakes rule. So a friend of a friend statements works for at most 6 steps. And therefore, this is one example of a 6 path that you can show. So in other words, so there is a proof. After checking 30 billion electronic messages, Microsoft have proved that 6 steps is maximum. So in other words, you are linked by a string of 7 or fewer acquaintances to Joe Biden, Bill Gates, Dalai Lama, Queen, and others. So we are all related in the sense that we can catch them in at most 6 steps. You may find the problem easy, but it's not easy because finding that particular path which will connect me with Bill Gates or Joe Biden is not going to be easy for any two objects in the system. But there is a recent paper cutting which says that degree of separation in the Facebook is just 3.57, not 6. What does it mean? Colloquially, it means that the Facebook network is very dense. It's close in the sense that we are able to reach from one Facebook member to another Facebook member by at most 3.57 steps. So why should we worry? Is that there are 1.94 billion vertices in the World Wide Web network. So we need we may need a new mathematics to explain this. With the help of computer science, we may be able to solve this. So there are several books on brain networks and the biological networks in general. So these are all standard books which you can look at it. So I stop with this social message of breaking the chain. So mass social distancing. And I'm happy to tell you that I've shared this information to at least 10,000 people after the pandemic through various webinars that I've been giving for last 1.5 years. So thank you all. I hope that I have not exceeded my time limit. When you start the game, you don't know how far we have gone. Okay, so thank you all for this opportunity and patient hearing. This is the beautiful Kerala backwaters, and this is the Kathakali that you see in Kerala. So you are welcome to Kerala definitely after pandemic. So welcome to Kerala, and thank you very much, Professor Rana, Soumi, and others. Thank you.
Thank you, Vijay Kumar, for your interesting talk. Let me open the forum for questions, remarks, suggestions, if any. So please say your name, what your name is, and if you can tell your affiliation or and then ask your question so that Professor Vijay Kumar can respond. And in the meantime, also please look at the feedback form, which is link is given in the chat box. So your feedback is...
Can I stop sharing?
Yeah, please stop sharing. That will be nice. So the feedback form is in the link is given in the chat box. Please do fill up the feedback form so that we are able to continue this kind of interactions more in math clinic. So anybody has a question or a comment or something to ask, so please unmute your mic and you can just say the question, no problem. Say your name and question. Yes. There was already one question in the chat box, which I answered from my side anyway, Vijaya. Can you say something for primary level students and teachers or K-5 about graph theory and such interactions? I already said that, look, handshake game is a very interesting game. I have played it with even with the 9th and 10th students in the classroom. I arrange them 2 at a time, 3 at a time, and 5 at a time, and then ask them to find out a pattern. You can play such things, or the 4-color problem is very interesting. You can make worksheets where one color is enough, or 2 colors are enough, or 3 are enough, and 4 are enough, or more such things. So they will discover something interesting which they will relate it with their childhood when they go to higher studies. So anything you want to add, Vijay?
No, what I told in the try to look at the chromatic number or the what is the minimum number of colors that you want to color the map of India.
Yeah.
I showed that it should be at least 3, but I didn't give you the answer. Yeah. But those who have attended this will be able to answer quickly. Let us try to find the answer. Yeah. To try to color the different states of India, yeah, starting from Kerala, for example, you will require another color for Tamil Nadu and another still different color for Karnataka. But Andhra Pradesh and Kerala can have the same color because we don't have a common border. So extend the 3 coloring of the 3 states to the full of India. Can you do with 3 or do you require 4? Any guess who knows the geography of India will be able to answer that. Is it, can you do with 3? Especially those, there are people from Uttar Pradesh or Chhattisgarh, Uttaranchal,
And before a new state comes up, do it fast.
Okay.
Else has a question or a remark? By the way, all this recording is available on the YouTube of today's thing. Today's webinar is available on YouTube. The link was already sent to you. So you don't have to bother that. What was that book Professor Vijay Kumar showed, or what was that link? You can always look at the recording and wind it back or forward, whichever way you want. That is the advantage of modern technology, which Arthur C. Clarke had predicted in one way or the other. Yeah, please. I think this is a subject, graph theory, which they say mathematics is everywhere, right? I would say graph theory is everywhere in mathematics. So what?
Yeah, I'll have a very simple looking puzzle, but it will turn out to be difficult later. That's what I told you with several puzzles.
Yeah, I think that is a problem, or that is the inheritory thing with all mathematical problems, which are easy to state are very difficult to solve.
Yeah.
Normally, for example, the four color problem, or this
Fermat's last theorem.
Fermat's last theorem.
Yeah.
That exactly. So all are very simple to state, but and you can state these things with the school level kids. You can share with school level kids, and so please. Anybody else has a, or see, I have a very bad habit. I pick up an audience and say, I want you to ask a question. So shall I do that for just Seti Saab? Can you hear me?
Who? Uh-huh.
Sindar Pal Singh Sethi.
I can hear you.
Yeah, are you from?
I remember the time you were there in the Khalsa College.
Yeah, I thought I have seen you in Khalsa College. Yes,
that's
right. Namaste, sir. You please introduce yourself. We have not met.
Yeah, please say.
My father was a head of department in the mathematics in Khalsa College, Bombay.
Oh.
And he was vice principal also there. And we had celebrated the anniversary. He has passed away in 91.
Uh-huh.
And Gujral Sahib, Rana Sahib came there to give us a lecture. And that's the time we met there. And my uncle also was a mathematician. He was with the NDA, Khadakwasla, head of department, and then later on principal there. So that's how I know Rana Sahib, through my brother. My brother is at the moment in California. Now I'm in New Jersey, in New York. I'm from USA. Yes.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Very interesting.
So, networking from Kerala to New Jersey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah.
So, fine. Really, okay. I have to think.
Please do fill up the feedback form. If anybody.
We'll do that. Yeah.
Anybody else has a question to ask, please ask. This is an opportunity for you to meet an expert in this kind of scenario where we are trying to bring face to face an expert to you. So I just want to ask Vijay, probably people are shy to ask. I find it how does one go about say, for example, I find easy to understand topology, metric spaces, algebra and such things, but I find it very difficult to sort of get the knack of discrete mathematics. So is there any input you'd like to students or teachers that how they should teach discrete mathematics, or how students should learn any way of mastering those tools of discrete mathematics? Because this is applicable everywhere, a lot of places.
Yeah. Teaching mathematics, discrete mathematics is easy in some sense, because we can take examples from the neighborhood, our own neighborhood, and try to connect it with some notions in discrete mathematics, which may not be easy with some other subjects. So start with the coloring problem. You start with the puzzle of seating. So seating problem is another problem which is related to what is called the Hamiltonian problem. So these are the things. And I always you can have a YouTube version of my friend Robin Wilson's lectures on graph theory. Robin Wilson, as I said, the son of Harold Wilson, and a very, very outstanding math popularizer. He would have given at least 2,500 lectures all over the world. So his videos are there in the YouTube, and this could be viewed, watched, so that you get how to introduce the concept easily.
Thank you. I'm asking finally that anybody has a comment, suggestion, question, please do it. So let me thank Vijay Kumar.
Okay.
Bringing a very easy looking subject and giving us the insights into it, how it is applicable almost everywhere in every field in mathematics, and how difficult it is to solve some of these problems. People have taken the help of computers to solve such problems, and still there are more problems. I think this is one of the fields which will always keep on exploding, because it connects human behavior, connects nature, connects share markets, connects almost everything.
Yeah.
So it will keep on throwing problems on us, and we hope graph theorists will keep on helping us solve these problems. Thank you, Vijay Kumar, for the interesting talk.
Thank you, sir.
And all of you, please take care. And before you leave, please fill up the feedback form.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.